My name's Elizabeth McBride. I am a senior, and I am the music branch representative for the Google Community Leaders Program of New Orleans. If you're curious what that is, just go on Facebook, look up New Orleans Google CLP, and there are a few branches. We have a music branch, and this fall we have, for example, a music business summit in the Music Village with the Ellis Marcellus Center, where we are volunteering to host a workshop with professionals from New Orleans to mentor individuals in sort of like a table-by-table basis. It's really awesome. It's a great learning experience. If you want experience volunteering, it is a volunteer option, and it's not like every week. It's a couple times a semester, and we pretty much get to design our own curriculums and just meet people who want to learn more about the music industry who otherwise don't have the ability to. So if that's something you're interested in doing, I will be outside in the lobby after forum. Otherwise, my email is elizabethcmcbride@gmail.com. Thank you.
Hey guys, I'm Caitlin. If you don't know me, I'm a senior TA in the studio. And one of my recording artists is looking to build his team, so I thought who better to ask than you guys. So this is Dev.
My name is Danion Green. This is Channel Dev. We starting a label slash management company called Lux Entertainment. You know, we came here, we looking for producers, managers, even artists too. So, and we like to make great music. We looking for some nice producers. We like music like Travis Scott, you know, ASAP, stuff like that. So we'll be in the lobby if anyone want to keep in contact with us. So, you know.
Thank you. What up, though? How you doing? What's up? Hi, people. What's up? So my album came out last Tuesday, though. Yeah. Yeah. This thing is way too short. I'm tall. The album is called Epitaph, E-P-I-T-A-P-H, and it's on iTunes, it's on Google Play. So if you guys want to support it, you find it there, Epitaph, E-P-I-T-A-P-H, and I go by Canvas, C-A-N-V-A-S. And if you don't like buying music that you don't know about and haven't heard yet, that's cool, because I've also got two singles on Spotify, one entitled Canvas, the other entitled Overwhelming. So if you want to check that out and you like the music, then go support the music.
Hey, what's up, everybody? I hope y'all having a good day. I'm here with Mike Hazel. My name's Josh, or Time, if you don't know me by that name. But I'm here to officially announce the Ugly God show we're throwing at the Willow. So if any of y'all, you know, if any of y'all splash with the water, you know, it's going to be saucing October 6th at the Willow, so y'all should come out. $15 pre-sale tickets is going to be, I think, 20 at the door, I believe. So get your pre-sale tickets from that guy, Jared, right there, who's sitting right there. You can get them from Tony Stan Campiano, or you can also get them from myself on Mike Hazel.
At home, hello, hello. Peace. Ella brought me here to talk to you. I'm gonna make it quick though. I have something free. It's just love. I'm gonna start it off with this. I love your hair. I've been staring at it the whole time. Who else? You, nice style. Loyola, see you. Whoa, I like you. And your hair. And all right, cool. My name is Evan Thibodeau. Spencer is a part of a beautiful Elysian Fields, beautiful band. My name is Evan Thibodeau. Back to me. Anyway, I love you. I'm just here to tell you one thing. Do you like Jimi Hendrix? Wait. Okay, I heard some people. Cool. So I remixed his whole album, Are You Experienced, and dropped that shit yesterday. So excuse my language. I graduated, by the way, last semester or something. So I'm gonna try to like make sure that I come back and I make sure that everything is kosher. But really, I just want to bring y'all some love, let y'all know that I'm gonna be continuing to release music. I do everything, by the way, like I told the homies. I shoot videos, produce, I do everything, you know, and just be on the lookout. Come contact me if you're an artist and you want to work with stuff. And if you like Jimi Hendrix, please go give yourself some time and relax and listen, because I made it to bring his message back into a new generation. So peace, love y'all. Oh, shout out Dolo Wine, by the way, who sponsors everything I do. Mike Hazel, peace.
What's up, friends? My name is Duncan Walgreen. I go by Wags on the weekends. I just had a really, really exciting summer. I just wanted to tell you guys about it real quick. I got to go play at Ultra Music Festival in Korea. That was amazing. Electric Forest Summer Camp. I made it out to Workout Festival in Ohio. So I'm making some moves here, and I'm looking for some help because I'm doing pretty much all of this by myself. So if you guys have any experience in managing artists or social media development, if you guys are really good at producing videos or any sort of music content and you want to collaborate with me, by all means, hit me up. My email is djwags, W-A-G-S, official, at gmail.com. And, oh yeah, I got three new tracks coming out in like 1 week, so keep an eye out for the SoundCloud. Thank you guys. You guys all rock.
Hey there, everyone. I'm Katie. I work at a music venue downtown called the Howlin' Wolf. I also work as the marketing director there. I do artist management for Rebirth Brass Band here in the city, and I do freelance festival operations. I'll be coming back in November to come actually talk to you guys on the panel here, but I just wanted to make a quick announcement for anyone looking for internship or street team opportunities. We're looking for anyone to satisfy that TBD, I guess, with Clayton. We need to make sure that it's an official internship. But we're looking for people to help promote our shows. We've got anything between large-scale national touring concerts, free comedy shows, comedy showcases, art showcases, all that kind of stuff. So I've got this flyer. My email is katie@thehowlinwolf.com. So you guys can pick it up outside at the table where you checked in. Or, yeah, just email me here. You can check out our website at thehowlinwolf.com. And I'll be seeing you guys in November, for those of you I don't speak to in the meantime. But yes, question. With an IE. Yeah, and there's like at least 100 of these flyers outside on the table, so you can just snag one. And if you need to contact, if you can't remember my email for some reason or another, Clayton can also help facilitate, so you can contact him too. But yeah, thanks for your time, guys.
Okay. Hey guys. So I don't know if any of you got the email last week about a surprise guest for Forum next Wednesday, which is going to take place of Monday night's Forum in Roussel at the same time. But you'll be getting that announcement in your emails at like 6:15. It should be coming out then, so stay tuned.
I just want to let y'all know, Dr. Lowe did the thing at the Neutral Ground this week, and you guys rocked. Oh my gosh, so much talent! I'm really impressed, and I just want to let you know I was proud of what I heard, and I hope to meet some of you more in person. But great.
Well, are you going to be at the next one, October 15th? All right. Yeah, it was a really good night Saturday, and thanks y'all so much for coming out. Okay, did everybody understand from Ethan's announcement that Forum next week is not on Monday, it's on Wednesday? Most of you don't have a conflict with this time, but a few of you do, and obviously you'll be excused, but please email us if that's the case. So Forum, no Forum on Monday, Forum instead on Wednesday in Roussel. Okay? Yes. And the guest is going to be announced. Okay. It's a very special guest, though. Question, yes. You can just email me. Yeah. If you have a conflict, so I can excuse you, you can just email me. Okay. Another announcement related to Forum attendance. Did anybody come through this door? Okay. Well, we're going to make it so that there's less congestion up at that door. We're going to make it from now on that you can also come through this door and leave through this door, right? That door goes right to the elevators on the second floor. Okay, so you can come in through the second floor by the elevators. If they came in that way, do they have to leave that way, or can they come in that way and leave this way? Okay, you heard that. You can come in that way and leave this way. And there's a little thing there to scan your dongle, my favorite word. Okay. Does dongle get applause now? Okay. Our guest today is someone very special that we've been trying to get here for about a year or so. So Jonathan Levine is a senior executive agent at Paradigm, where he's been for about 20 years. Before that, he was in New York at William Morris Agency and Artists and Audiences. And he has been booking agent for some of the biggest touring acts in the United States over that period. And one of the most insignificant acts that he booked during that time was God Street Wine for about 7 years. But but nonetheless, this man literally dictated where I would go from night to night for about 7 years. So he held complete control of my life, and he did it very, very well. And he was much more than just a booking agent. He was a real inspiration to work with, and he was a mentor. And he's just a very, very intelligent man. So some of his other career accomplishments: he's the winner of the Bobby Brooks Agent of the Year Award. He's a partner in the UK-based live music collective Communion, which was co-founded by Ben from Mumford & Sons. He's on the board of Phil Lesh's charitable Unbroken Chain Foundation. And he's also on the board of the Americana Music Foundation. And please welcome, along with Billy O'Connell, to interview him, Jonathan Levine.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, hello, everybody. You are so lucky to have in your presence the Jonathan Levine. I was just realizing as Lo was introducing Jonathan that one of the more influential business books that I ever read in my life, and which all of you who have taken my management class and who will take my management class have to read, came to me because of this man. One day we were sitting together and talking about business, and Jonathan started citing Jim Collins' book, Good to Great. And I went home and read it that night, and it became a core part of my business life in management and in business development for artists. And when I incorporated it into artist business, I think that I believed that I was doing something that hadn't really been done before. And so every time I use the term values alignment, I was explaining to Jonathan that I'm like a caricature. I'm a walking joke in this program because I use that term so often. And I can blame him for that because essentially that conversation was about, the conversation we had that turned me onto that book was all about the first who, then what school of business. That you it's more important who you're working with than what it is you're doing. And I could not recommend a better who than this gentleman. So please help me welcome Jonathan Levine.
Thank you again. Thank you. Thanks, man.
Welcome.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Jonathan, normally at this point in an interview, the earliest point, we would talk to you about your particular path into this business. What took the kid who grew up as a fan of music and turned you into somebody who wanted to work in music?
Well, first, to you and to Lo, thank you for having me. It's a privilege and honor to be here. I always feel when I'm asked to do any kind of panel or speaking engagement like this that it's a real privilege to do it. And if anything I say helps somebody, then that's a great thing. I'm not used to being on stages. I'm not used to getting even one person clapping for anything I do, let alone a room full. So it's a little daunting because I spend my life behind the stage doing what I do. I've had one job for 31 years. This is the only thing I've ever done, is work on the artist representation side of the touring industry. It was a calling, I think. It was something that I felt at a very, very young age that if I couldn't play third base for the Red Sox, then I was going to have to do something that my love and passion for music was going to allow me to do. And while I wouldn't have been able to tell you at my early ages what that would have been, I was very, very, very certain that it was going to be something in and around the rock and roll world. And like a lot of us, I started playing music. I started playing drums in bands at a very young age. I played in almost every conceivable kind of band that I probably could have played in. And I was telling Billy earlier, I went to school at Southern Illinois University in Carbondale, which is southern Illinois, southern tip of the state. And I was trying to feel my way through what college was going to do and what I was going to do with college and what it was going to do with me. And we weren't getting along too well. I was spending way too much time playing music and touring and booking my band and kind of doing the thing that you do when you're a young person playing in a band. And fortunately, as a lot of things in life can be with fate and timing, we had a professor that started on the faculty there that lived in Nashville and wanted to start a music business program. And needless to say, there was no music business to study in Carbondale, Illinois, so he took those of us who were interested, put us on a bus each month, and drove us down to Nashville. And we went to Nashville back when Nashville was specializing in both kinds of music, country and Western. And
I played
and
both kinds.
I was 19, 20, and 21 years old during those few years doing that. And it gave me insight that while I always felt that I was a student of the business, not that I was designed to be, because again, when Billy quotes from good to great, don't make me out to be any scholarly kind of person. That is the one and only business book I've ever read, ever, seriously.
Lucky for you.
But it's a good one. It's a good one. But that being said, I was always fascinated by the little things that would get my attention growing up. I would love to read liner notes. I would love to read who were the people involved in the bands that I was a fan of growing up. And it gave me enough insight that I had certainly an understanding of there being a music business, but it wasn't until I had the opportunity to be in Nashville and to take classes and learn about everything from producing and engineering and songwriting and contract law and management and touring and all these little things that were being baked into this recipe of what I was doing by booking the band that I played in, by making the flyers for the band that I played in, by making mailing lists for the band that I played in, by getting my teeth kicked in by promoters for the band that I was playing with. I mean, it just was just one of those kind of street smart kind of things that gave me a little bit of insight. And that's that when I finished the program and ended up with this specialization in music business, then came the hard part, then what to do with it and how to do what I think is the real art to what this business is, which is to set yourself up for success, to put yourself in a place where success is at least likely to find you, as opposed to waiting for it to come knocking at your door.
Right.
I knew I had to go be proactive and try and figure out what that was going to be or where that was going to be. And I knew of a guy that had a small agency in Boston that I had known of this guy and this company for several years. And And I went, I was out in that area, and I quote unquote ran into him. It was completely by design on my part. He thought it was coincidental. And he asked what I had been doing in all the years it had been since I had last seen him. And I said, I've been preparing to come work for you. And he said, really? And what would that be like? And I said, it would be me moving from Chicago to Boston to come work for you. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, we should talk about that. And I said, we should. Mm-hmm. And he gave me, I mean, again, it was like these, you know, things that happen in life. It was just fortuitous that the timing of it was good. And I got very lucky, and he put me in a position where within a few weeks I had moved from, I drove from Chicago to Boston in my car with my skis on the top and a suitcase and went to work for him for, you know, maybe a fiddle could come out here. But I mean, it was, you know, $100 a week to learn how to be an agent.
Yeah.
And again, while I've, my journey over the 31 years has taken me from Chicago to Boston to New York City to Northern California to Nashville, the whole time I've done it has just been one job.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that's good or bad. It's just, for my case, it's been what it's been. You know, I haven't worn different hats. I don't know what it's like to be a promoter, or I don't know what it's like to work for a management company or a record company or a publisher. This is the only thing I've done is represent artists in the touring world.
Right.
And that's how I got the start. And again, I've been absolutely incredibly fortunate to be able to have a job like this and work in this profession mm-hmm. in the ever-changing landscape known as the music business for the last 31 years. Yep. And that's the story of walking uphill in the snow every day to school.
Both ways. You know?
Both ways.
To and from. So something you said jumped out at me. You talked about us making our own luck, basically. That you don't wait for something to knock at the door, but you go out and you make your own opportunities. As you got into life as an agent, working as an artist representative, did you see a way that you, or have you seen ways that you've implemented that philosophy, that idea of making your own luck on behalf of artists in your representation of them?
To a degree, yes. I mean, only in that if there was a manual or a guide that I had to follow, then every band that I've been privileged to work with would be a big band. And obviously that's not the case. I mean, we know what the realities are. You guys are in a arts and entertainment program here. We all know that in the world of whether it's professional sports or music or something in film or television, theatrical, whatever it may be, that the decks are stacked against you.
Absolutely.
And the odds are huge to have any degree of success or traction. Mm-hmm. So I can't sit here and quote quotes from good to great or from anything that I've done that is a guaranteed path to anything mm-hmm. other than I do believe that proactive representation is the way to be. And what mm-hmm. I mean by that is I think, and again, these, everything that I say is just my humble opinion. It doesn't mean it's right. It's just how I view things. The work that we did together with God Street Wine, or the work that I've done with some of the incredible artists that I've been privileged to work with, which range from the Grateful Dead to the Black Eyed Peas and the Black Crows and bands of then and new artists that are coming up today that are making their own way, who are part of the what I consider the face of Nashville these days. Mm-hmm. I think that My old-fashioned view of things comes from all the days and all the years that I spent playing drums in bands.
Yeah.
That the only part of a career that you have any control over in the music business is standing on a stage playing a gig.
Yeah.
And while you can't control if somebody's ever gonna write about you or play your music mm-hmm. or broadcast your music or download your music, or sync your music or license your music, nobody can ever stop an artist from standing on a stage and playing. And it doesn't mean it's at the Superdome, and it doesn't mean it's at the Sanger. Mm-hmm. You know, it could be a little bar. It could be a hole in the wall. And I've booked and still book plenty of small clubs, you know, in this planet.
You can change lives at that level.
You absolutely can. And what you just said is something that I believe in with everything that I do, that the right music the right song at the right moment can do just that. It can change a life. And so from the standpoint of trying to place yourself in success's way as opposed to placing yourself in failure's way, I think from the standpoint of touring, which is, again, my little one-dimensional one-trick pony that I am, that I've never compromised on the integrity of the people that I've been privileged to work with. In other words, I've not been in the volume business. I don't sign a lot of artists, and I only sign artists that make my hair stand up. I only I'm not saying that I've signed every act that I've signed has gone on to achieve levels of greatness and success, but I can confidently and honestly say in 31 years with the artists that I've worked with, I've never signed anybody that I didn't think was great.
Yeah.
And I won't use profanity, but that is effing great, you know. Mm-hmm. And I speak French fluently, but I've made a real a real point of just trying to find that first.
Yeah.
Because if the passion and the belief, if I don't have it, then
you can't.
There's already a strike against them, and then the notion of me trying to place them in opportunities that might allow for success.
Yeah.
Is already not going to happen because there's something either too mediocre or too much like something else or plenty of other things that are out there. Mm-hmm. So I view that the touring world, I've said this many times, so sometimes I get tired of hearing myself say it, but I view that the touring world, if you're picturing a train, that the locomotive that's pulling the train is gigs, is playing shows, is standing on a stage and commanding an audience. And that the rest of the cars that are being pulled behind the train, if they're filled up with good press and radio or sales, whatever record sales mean these days, or streams or downloads or syncs or licenses or placements, that's great. But if none of those things happen, which may well be the case, 99 times out of 100, you still can play shows.
Yeah.
So...
So shows as a tool of business development, obviously live performance is, I have a thing I say to my classes all the time that, I will never manage an artist who doesn't play live, because the live gig has the presents you with the opportunity to shrink conversion, that creating awareness, building connection, monetizing the connection, that like 1, 2, 3 of marketing. Can take 3 months, 6 years, 3 years. But you can shrink that down to 30 minutes in a gig where somebody walks in, sees a new artist play, falls in love with it, goes to the merch desk and buys a CD or supplies their email to a list. And so your ability to sort of make sure that you represent only artists where you feel passion, that you feel passion for, who you can represent with enthusiasm and creativity, do their thing. That's obviously where the rubber meets the road for you, is it not?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I guess what I'd be interested in knowing is that, you've been in this business for 31 years. Can you discuss some of the differences that you've seen in the business from when you began to now? With the either via consolidation or the difference in the world we live in, from being a world in the music business devoted to retail and hard copies, now digital, everything's streamed in our pocket on demand. Have you been able to perceive any changes in the live business precipitated by these? By these factors?
I did a panel during the Americana Music Fest in Nashville 2 years ago where Ann Powers, who, if anybody knows her world, she's a critic for NPR and for the New York Times. She's really an unbelievable woman. Yeah. And she had put together a panel that was doing, I don't want to call it a case study, but it was in essence a case study on one of the artists that I represent, a guy named Sturgill Simpson. And Sturgill has had this just amazing last several years that have been happening without any real driver coming from the normal places that these things tend to come from. Mm-hmm. It's been coming from this wonderful, good old-fashioned word of mouth and great press, but virtually no radio, certainly not many record sales, no licenses, or, you know, wouldn't allow his songs to be in a commercial or anything like that.
But let me say, word of mouth. I mean, we're living in the golden age of word of mouth. I mean, is this not the best time for word of mouth when everybody has a megaphone and a platform and the ability to sort of hypercharge word of mouth?
Yeah,
I mean, it's amazing for somebody like that.
No question.
I'm sorry. So continue.
No, so during the panel, which was made up, it was Sturgill's publicist, his manager, his attorney, record company representative, and me. Mm-hmm. And just the way that Anne was conducting the interview, I happened to be the last person she asked the opening round of questions to, mm-hmm. because she went down the table. And she got to me and she said, well, you know, everybody has just been talking about the just incredible amount of change that the music business has seen, mm-hmm. in every way. So I'm sure with all this change, your job for what you do is dramatically different than it was when you started.
Yeah.
And I said, on one level, hasn't changed a bit, because it still boils down to the fact that you play a gig, you get paid.
Yeah.
And that's a wonderful thing, especially as the New World Order continues to evolve as to how you make money from streaming or from digital or mm-hmm. from any of the other revenue streams that either used to exist or don't exist, or revenue streams that are being reimagined or rethought, or revenue streams that we don't even know of yet that certainly technology will provide more opportunities for. Mm-hmm. I was at a meeting in Nashville the other day where somebody was talking, just to get off track for a half a second, but somebody was talking about virtual tickets and how when your show at Ryman Auditorium has sold its 2,200 tickets out, mm-hmm. doing VR ticketing and giving people opportunities that could be in any city anywhere in the world,
sure.
not just to be at the show, but to have a 360-degree view of the
show,
to see what
it's
like
show.
To be on stage, yeah. or behind the drum riser or
yeah.
whatnot. I mean, certainly we are going there. I'm not the king of technology, and I'm not on the cutting edge of some of those things. You know, again, I always try and be a student of what's happening, so yeah. I too can be learning, because my job is, I've never, just like I think that artist development doesn't have an end,
yeah.
artist development is something that, I represent Dr. John from New Orleans here, who's 75 years old, and Dr. John's world is still artist development. We're still making decisions for Mac that are based on doing the right things for his career. It's
yeah.
not like he's ever going to get to a place and kick his feet up and say, I'm good. We're still doing what we're doing.
Yeah.
And so I view the same for me. You know, whatever knowledge I've accumulated in the time that I've done this is still, in the scheme of things, a fraction of what there is to know and learn.
Yeah.
But I do think that that there's nuances, again, of my job that haven't changed a bit.
Yeah.
And then there's other aspects that have changed dramatically as to how people can connect with an audience, about how the fact that since the time I've been doing this, the four gatekeepers who determined who got signed to a record deal and how that music got out, well, I think that's a great thing that those gates are no longer there,
yeah.
that anybody has a chance to create music, whatever kind of music that may be, mm-hmm. and find a way to get that music out into the masses through a device in your hand.
Yeah.
Will.i.am is always talking and has been talking to me since 2003 about band to hand,
yeah.
how everything eventually, and it already is that way now, but in yeah. 2003 it was pretty interesting to yeah. hear somebody talk about
yeah.
it,
yeah.
that it'll go band to hand. It'll go from the artist to a device in your hand. And the need for distribution and record companies will go away.
Yeah, those types of entities will be disintermediated, which, lucky for you and me, people like artists and managers, we still have a role in that band to hand process, don't we?
Yes.
So yeah. I mean, there's something in that for y'all that, you know, you need to understand that there's certain aspects of the institutional music business, the legacy music business, that have been, you know, made either irrelevant or specialized, but a lot of other things, you know, are constant, and certainly one of them.
Yes.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, consolidation, again, needless to say, has been a big, big part of mm-hmm. of what's happened in the music business, and for those that are pay attention to names like Live Nation or AEG, who in just here in New Orleans, that, you know, they are, AEG is now owns half of Jazz Fest, and
yeah.
I mean, they're, you know, they're everywhere, these entities. They're giant global multinational corporations and run very differently, but I mean, they've taken a lot of the music business and changed the touring world,
yeah.
my world, dramatically. But that's also made for great opportunities for entrepreneurs, as there always will be with those. You have companies that are based here in New Orleans, like Hookah Entertainment and folks like that, and Superfly, who started their whole thing that led to Bonnaroo and Outside Lands and everything that they did. We started with doing late night shows with those guys way back in the day, long before there was a Bonnaroo. Yep. So, you know, I think that the one thing, and I learned this literally like day one when I started, is that the only constant in our business is change.
Yeah.
Change is around us all the time.
Yeah.
And like with anything, whether you're talking about just simply technology or the evolution of what show business may be, whichever area of it that you happen to be in or happen to be pursuing, that the one thing you can take home every single night is that change is constantly in the air.
Yeah.
And so those who are living with it and evolving with it have a chance to, again, place themselves in areas where success may happen.
Mm-hmm.
And those who choose not to are making it harder. Not mm-hmm. to say it's impossible, but they're mm-hmm. making it harder.
So do you see a role for planning in I mean, I'm asking a disingenuous question. You obviously see a role for planning in an artist's career, and what kind of role do you as an agent, or do you see the agency playing in planning in through artist development, business development for artists?
It may be because my lenses are really biased.
Yeah,
I do view that the agency world and the agent's world is and can be, and in most cases should be, the hub of the wheel, not a spoke on the wheel.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and our company has, when Billy and I first met and when I started working with Lowe back in the day, while I did work for the biggest of the big, the William Morris Agency way back in the day, the company that I've been with for these last 20 plus years started as and has been long believed to be probably the finest boutique booking agency that the music business has known. It was a little company called Monterey Peninsula Artists. We were based in Monterey, California, and we had Fish and Dave Matthews and Aerosmith and all the entities of the Grateful Dead. And I mean, we had an unbelievable roster. And it was a small company based in the sticks of Monterey, California, doing what we were doing while the rest of the music business was slaving away, mm-hmm. doing what it did in New York and L.A. and Nashville and wherever else. And and in 2004, as the world changed dramatically, as everybody knows, after 9/11, 2002, 2003, 2004, those 3 years also started to see a lot of change in the music business and the touring business. A lot of the consolidation was starting to take place. And we found ourselves in a position where we had largely been left to our own devices in that beautiful hamlet of Northern California, mm-hmm. and the barbarians that are out there in the music business, the sharks as they are, were starting to circle our fences every day, or our doors.
Yeah.
And to this day, we still have a policy that I'm really proud of, to be honest with you, that I wish existed everywhere. It just doesn't. I'd be naive to think it does, but we don't poach and we don't try and steal bands and lure from other agencies, and we don't steal employees, and we just try and rise above the some of those nuances that exist in the business. But around 2002-03 in the post 9/11 world, while we had been largely left to our own devices around, you know, in the years leading up to that, mm-hmm. we found that our bigger competitors, we were a small boutique, just a booking agency. I mean, that's all we could do was just book tours. We didn't have access to the other aspects that define what Paradigm, the company now I'm a part of, which is bought Monterey Peninsula Artists all those years ago. We're what we would now refer to as a vertically integrated company.
Yeah.
We didn't have the opportunity to provide for our clients something that might help their career, whether it's in film or television or with a placement.
Let's pause for a second just to explain vertical integration.
Yes.
Because I don't think that's a concept they're very well aware of. When we talk about vertical integration, we're talking about the fact that if you're signed to Paradigm as a musician, but you want to be involved in film, they can help you make connections in film through the other aspects of the agency. That's just a for instance, but there's also licensing opportunities that can be had. Do you want to speak a little more to that sort of vertical integration?
Yeah. So as a booking agency, we just booked tours. And when Paradigm and Monterey Peninsula Artists came about, Paradigm did not have a music division. And to the credit of Sam Gores, who owns the company, just one guy, it's not a corporation, it's not a giant board of directors, and it's still to this day just one guy that owns our company. When he decided to start a music division, he set his sights on the crown jewel. He wanted Monterey Peninsula Artists. That's, and there was a couple years of kicking the tires. He kicked our tires, we kicked his, to make sure it was a good fit. And in December of 04, that deal was finished. In January of 05, it became public. And we went from being just a booking agency to a talent agency. And the big difference in that is that we now had this vertical integration. And that makes up our company, which is film, television, theatrical, literary, commercial, branding, sponsorship, soundtracks, film scores, licensing, syncs, placements, all of it. And that is something that on paper can look very nice and shiny and sexy to certain people. Part of our job is also to be realists with what that means. Just because we have it doesn't mean that that might be something else that assures anybody's success.
Right.
You're still going to be swimming upstream. You're still going to be dealing with the realities of what that means. But if we do our jobs and we do our jobs well for the right people, then it is giving them other opportunities that they may not have had. And certainly when we were just little Monterey Peninsula Artists booking agency that we couldn't do. Right. So when we found ourselves in the new world order as the music business has changed, having to compete with competitors who had those other aspects of being in a vertically integrated company, is when we decided that we were going to go make that happen. And again, we didn't take it lightly because we knew that part of what was sacred of our company was just how small and nimble we were.
Yes.
And you know, that's a trade-off. I mean, I would be lying if I sat up here today both, you know, with a microphone and with cameras pointing at me and say that I don't miss the days of representing 30 artists. You know, that's not what it is anymore. But that's also, if I was thinking and living like that, then I might be thinking and living with a 2002 or 3 or 4 mindset.
Yeah, yeah.
And while there's plenty of great boutique agencies that still exist and do great work, what they don't have is the ability to offer certain artists who have the opportunity or the vision or the talent to possibly cross over or have other opportunities in the other areas of what we do
when they're appropriate.
Music,
when they're appropriate.
When appropriate.
Right?
You know?
Because it's not, as you said, just because you have it doesn't mean it's applicable to everyone. It doesn't mean that if it is applicable, they can necessarily score those opportunities, right? But where you can increase the odds, you increase the odds of some kind of crossover.
Yes.
Right? It's phenomenal timing. It was phenomenal timing for you guys at that time, right? To do that just as recorded music was struggling. You became much more valuable player in the eyes of the artists you were working with in that way because of the ability to extend their brand and to do those things.
Right.
You characterized agency as the hub of the artist's wheel, which, as it happens, I tend to characterize management as the hub of the artist's wheel.
Understand.
But my excuse is always that the manager has a fiduciary relationship to the to the artist business, that we're regulated in such a way as to kind of keep us about the best interest of the artist, not going for the deal. But I think that a great agency takes it upon themselves to behave in that way as well, and that's been my impression of you over the years, is that it's not about going to get the money where you can get the money, and making decisions that are perhaps cynical or that shorten an artist's lifespan or reduce their market value. Can you speak a little bit about how you preserve and how you can go get the deals that are to be had, but still preserve the integrity of the artist and still develop the artist in a way that is sustainable and organic and doesn't feel premeditated?
It's a great question. Everybody that works in the world that I work in, we all have different styles and different philosophies. Yeah. My philosophy speaks very much to that, in that I almost have a Zen way of looking at it. Artist development, again, is a process, and it's not, I don't view it as a race. I'm not looking at at bands or artists as records, and I'm not looking at them as songs. I'm looking at them as living, breathing entities that are creative forces that are trying to find a way to have their music connect to the world out there, which again, now more than ever, there's more ways for that music to find its way out there. You know, the good and bad of that is, the good news is anybody can do it, and the bad news is anybody can do it.
Yeah.
It still means you still have to have some degree of quality control.
Yeah.
And I will never sit here and say that I've figured it out, because I haven't.
Yeah.
You know, I don't view myself as being a gatekeeper. I might be a gatekeeper into the artist that I choose to work with, but just because I do or don't doesn't mean that something isn't viable in any other way.
Mm-hmm.
But to speak to your point, I view that the process, this process of artist development is something that when you're thinking in terms of a career as opposed to an album or an album cycle or or whatever, is something that can take years and years to develop.
Yeah.
And if somebody...
And may require pivots along the way, right? You're not just on a trajectory that needs to play out a certain way.
Right.
You know, there can be bends in the road, but also bends in your decision making, in your own aesthetic.
Correct. And the plans, when you refer to that word, you know, for me the plan is always we're trying to build a base for our audience. We're trying to allow their opportunities to control their own destiny by standing on that stage and playing that gig. Mm-hmm. To be able to sell tickets, to base everything they're doing on being able to sell a hard ticket.
Right.
And to be able to do that, again, it's not rocket science. There's an art to it, but it's not rocket science. Well, how many kinds of gigs are there? That's not unlimited. You've got you got festivals, you have fairs, you have college shows, you have what we call soft ticket events, where there's not a lot of pressure or onus on the artist to actually sell the ticket, but it's an opportunity for them to stand on a stage and play. There are many different ways that somebody can stand on a stage to play, but there's only one reason they should be doing it.
Yeah.
And that is, how does whatever that gig is, whether they're playing Jazz Fest or Lollapalooza or Coachella, or they're playing opening up for the Lo Faber Band or the Billy O'Connell String Ensemble, if they're playing the gig, then they're doing it for a purpose. And for my job, it is, how is that helping us to build a base in that city, in that region, in that area? And how are we taking an opportunity that might allow an artist that's playing at Coachella or playing at Newport Folk Festival to use that to build that area and that region and that market?
Yeah.
And from that standpoint, I'll use the Sturgill Simpson idea or example as an example, where in 2015, just another quick aside, we live in a culture where it's just oversaturated with festivals.
Yeah.
I, this is my own opinion. There are a lot of festivals out there.
Yeah.
Big ones, small ones, great ones, not great ones. I think earlier this year, the number going into the summer before the festival season started was 23 pretty substantial festivals had gone under. And that means a lot of people being out a lot of money, not just the artists, but the vendors, people who work for those companies, those festivals, those entities. And in a business where there's a lot of people that want to look for the shortcut or the quick fix, and I'm sitting here in kind of my Zen role saying, it's not about the shortcut. We're trying to build a career, not capitalize on a moment. So using that example to put money where our mouths are, with Sturgill's case, you know, as hard as it is and as long as it took for him to develop awareness and traction and have what's happening in his world happen, in 2015, we had well over 50 festival offers in North America.
Wow.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
And most people, most managers and most agents would probably be saying, confirm, confirm, confirm. Let's take them all. We strike while the iron's hot, or at least strike while it's lukewarm. We took 14 of them, and we passed on 36 of them. Most people were thinking we were out of our minds.
Right.
But I really believe, while he gets a lot of people comparing him to the next something, and I'm not really interested in representing the next anything. I like to represent the first something and let others represent the next.
But that's a lazy thing anyway.
He was being certainly hailed, and still is hailed in a lot of ways, as being the person to likely inherit the crown of a Johnny Cash, a Waylon, a Willie Nelson. I few actually at bigger than that. I think Sturgill's got as much John Lennon and Bob Dylan in him as he does the some of the country acts that he's compared to. But just for the point of an example, is that I think that the onus is on us, meaning the managers and the artist representatives, the agencies, to think in terms of long-term strategic planning and not striking because the opportunity's there. And to give a case in point, I'm sure most people are familiar with the ACL Festival down the road in Austin, the Austin City Limits Festival. And ACL came and offered us a slot in 2014 for Sturgill to play. And I passed on it. Now, I didn't just pass on it on my own. Again, it's a conversation we have with the manager, and it's part of the strategy and this blueprint that we had developed years ago. And they were really perplexed. Well, we're ACL. Don't you realize who we are? Why would you pass on the offer? And I said, let me ask you a question. Is the festival not going to be around again in 2015? And they thought I was being a smartass. And they said, no, we'll be around. And I said, what about 2016? You think you'll be around then? And I said, yeah. He said, yeah. I said, well, good, because I'm pretty sure that Sturgill will be too.
Yeah.
We're not in a hurry to do this. Right. And when you play the festival, a lot of people don't think of the idea or the notion that it's there. It's not like a coupon book where you just get your coupon book and you can call it in every time you want it. It could be 5 years before we play it again.
Yeah. So you want to play
and
ACL
I wanted to have the timing be perfect, not good. And the day and the slot and the time that they were offering, forget the money, was really poor. It was just not ideal for him. And on top of it, it wasn't a great payday. And so we felt pretty confident that we can revisit this in 2015. And when he played it last year, he played it on the day, the time, the slot, and the position that made sense. And he was paid a lot more than he was would have been. And so putting that to last year's example of turning down 36 festivals, the 14 that we took, we took Coachella and Stagecoach. He was the third artist in history to ever play both Coachella and Stagecoach. That's a big deal. He played Farnborough and Governor's Ball in the New York market, and he played Big Barrel and Firefly in the D.C. Delaware market. So of the 14 we took, six were doubles. So we only played eight festival markets last year. This year in 2016, zero by design. Passed on all of them. And again, not because there's a level of cockiness or anything. It's just that we've got a master plan. We're trying to build his hard ticket touring base. I get a lot of grief from people that I've worked with who tease me a lot with all my kind of Grateful Dead sensibilities in me. And there's a reason that that band stood the test of time. It was certainly their music, first and foremost. But it was also the fact that every decision they made, bar none, was made on what was right for the music, what was right for the community, and what was right for the presentation and preservation of both, and then figure out the deal, then figure out the business model to make it work. So I've used that very basic way of thinking with the Black Eyed Peas or with Will or with Fergie or with, you know, with Sturgill or whomever it's been over the course of the years. And while I get teased a lot for it, it worked for those guys.
You do a lot worse. For a lot of bands. You do a lot worse than learning from the Grateful Dead.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of my most edgy marketing ideas ever were adaptations of things that they were doing before I was ever in the business.
There's books written about the marketing aspects of the Grateful Dead.
Radical
and they don't sit there and ever take credit for it. You know, Phil Lesh will say that allowing our fans to tape our shows was the greatest decision we never made. They never sat down and had a big business meeting to say, let's let our fans tape shows. Their fans were taping the shows. They just decided to not interfere and get in the way. And just let it happen. I mean, that to me, again, in the course of all the planning and strategy that this job does require, there are certain things, which is why they call it artist development, that you want to let it happen. You know, maybe your artist, even if you have the opportunity to be playing Ryman Auditorium at the Mother Church of Country Music in Nashville, just because you can do it, doesn't mean that the timing might be right to do it. I'd rather, when you look at, I use New York City venues as examples. I'd rather a band go from the Mercury Lounge to the Bowery Ballroom to Webster Hall to the Beacon Theater to Radio City Music Hall to Madison Square Garden, if they can ever do all of that. I'd rather the trajectory be that way and take the right steps than start leapfrogging.
And or, I do, or bouncing up and down.
Right.
I mean, you know, that happens too.
Absolutely. And again, because I tend to think in terms of a career and not a moment. When I moved to Nashville, which is only 4.5 years ago, I'm still pretty new to Nashville. When I moved there, there is this giant multi-billion dollar industry called the commercial country industry. Mm-hmm. Far be it for me to say anything negative about it. It is a big business. And while I'm not deeply immersed in that business, I'm not in that business, but I'm not really in yeah. that world per se on a daily level. One of the things that I heard a lot when I got to town, and again, now this is only 4.5 years ago. These are not conversations that were happening there in the 80s when yeah. I was taking classes there.
Yeah.
Was, well, we're in between singles, so we're not working. Our album mm-hmm. didn't hit, so we're not touring.
Mm-hmm.
That's a foreign language to me.
Yeah.
I don't know what that means, because to me, my bands work.
Yeah.
They have been able to take control and create some degree of control of their own destiny
yep.
by using the premise of what I've been sitting here talking about, yeah. standing on a stage and playing
yeah.
a show.
Yeah.
And using whatever that opportunity is, whether it's been a college show or a fair or a festival or whatever it may be, to figure out a way to build a base in that market. You get a chance to open for the Low Faber Band, who's playing the Sanger Theater in New Orleans, mm-hmm. then how are you going to come back to the Cambridge Room at the House of Blues
yeah.
and use that as an opportunity to use the rooftop that you just borrowed from Low to play on his stage, yeah,
to cast
his
a wider
show,
net and bring
to
in.
Try and use that for you.
Yeah.
Because when you do play that festival or that package or that opening act slot, you still don't have control of the presentation.
Right.
It's a venue or a ticket price, or a promoter, or a mm-hmm. night of the week,
yep.
or a bill that you had zero say in. Yeah. But if we're coming back to play the small little Cambridge Room at the House of Blues
yeah.
uptown here, then at least we can choose the night of the week and mm-hmm. who's on the bill and yep. what the ticket price is yep. and how we present that show mm-hmm. to the public, so that band can take that opportunity that they may have had playing at Jazz Fest or playing at Voodoo mm-hmm. or playing in whatever fashion that they did in New Orleans
yep.
to build their New Orleans base.
Right.
And you build the New Orleans base by also paying attention to Shreveport mm-hmm. and Baton Rouge
right.
and Lafayette. Right. And you build Texas by not just paying attention to Dallas, Houston, and Austin,
right.
but by paying attention to regions,
right.
to, you know, that bumper sticker of think globally and act locally.
Act locally.
That's,
yeah.
that's
music.
How I look at it.
Yeah, yeah, that's great. Well said. Well said. I'd like to, before we're done, and we're getting close to the end here. I'd like to ask you just. I think it might be interesting, and I like to ask this question as often as I can. What's the? Can you identify something that you would characterize as a failure that you would not trade for a success?
Yeah, I mean, if we had a 3-month symposium here, I could sit here and talk about my failures forever.
But a failure you value so highly that you wouldn't trade it for a success.
I would say that, wow, it's such a great question. And again, because my failures far outweigh my successes,
as do all of ours,
which one to focus on. I've missed a lot of boats. Mm-hmm. I've missed a lot of great opportunities because I have stuck to my guns about not wanting to sign bands or be involved with things mm-hmm. that don't move me passionately.
Mm-hmm.
And I can count many examples of bands who have achieved unbelievable levels of success.
Mm-hmm.
That either I was asleep on or it just didn't move my needle enough.
Right.
So I guess, while those failures are many, the thing I would come back to on the positive side is still never compromising integrity
mm-hmm.
and never, ever selling out. Now, again, there's people who have had way more success than I could dream of having mm-hmm. that have different philosophies and approaches, but I'm going to stick to my core values
yeah.
of only being driven by that which moves me, that
yeah.
which I feel passionate by, and that which I feel I can contribute a significant amount of my energy to help make a difference. There's only so many hours in a day. I still find myself constantly overwhelmed with work,
mm-hmm.
overwhelmed with the volume that is coming at me, overwhelmed with emails and texts and travel and
yeah.
all the nuances that this business demands.
Yeah.
And it's certainly no picnic every day.
Yeah.
But I love it. I
yeah.
am absolutely out of my mind with the privilege of what I get to do.
And if I may, I mean, it's only because of who you're doing it with and for, right? You're sticking to your core values and making sure that they align with the people around you and the people that you work with. I mean, not to make it about the old joke, you know, my old cartoon line here. But the reason that you have the energy, the creativity, the enthusiasm for what it is you're doing is because it's not a drag. It feels light, not heavy. Even though you're harried and exhausted and you have hard days and you have good days, it's because you're connected, right? You're connected with passion and tenacity and the ability to sort of act as a leader in your world. And I think that this is something that we like to try to communicate to the students in this room as much as possible, and I never miss the opportunity to do that. But I think that you're a phenomenal example of exactly that. I think also that that if I may, part of what you talked about never sleeping on opportunity is also what makes opportunity. And I think that if I were to underscore anything that you had to say and give you the opportunity to comment on this again, it's that the odds are so stacked against you, those of you in this room who want to make a living in music or entertainment, film, anything else. You guys are really playing from behind. From day one, you're playing from behind. And you can't afford to give anyone an advantage. And you can't afford to deny yourself any asset that you may have. And so everything that you can do, every bit of good practice that you can do, every bit of data you can collect, every good person to bring onto your side, every routine bit of process that you can build into your system, every goal you can set, every number you can identify that you wish to measure, all of that is what Jonathan is characterizing as working from your passion and with the people you ought to be working with and in a meaningful and well, I guess in a meaningful way, period. And I think that I think I'd like to thank you for so beautifully reflecting the values of this program in your comments. And by all means, I'd like to offer the students a chance to ask you any questions, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
So first, thank you to John. But anyway,
well, thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks. Thank you, Barry. I appreciate it. I would say to that end of what you were just saying, the music business, and it's no different than, I guess, if I was a sports agent or if I was a theatrical agent or a film agent or television agent. And the first question people always want to ask is, who do you represent?
Yeah.
And I understand that because people want to know who you represent. And I'd rather be thought of not by who I represent. I'd rather be thought of by how I represent who I represent. Because the business is going to judge me. They're going to define me. They're going to put me in a box based on who I represent. I can't control that. I can't. There's nothing I can do about that. What I can control is how I represent who I represent.
Right.
So while I may not be the biggest and the most successful and the most powerful anything, I can take a lot of pride in the fact that I have never compromised my own values by knowing that I represent who I represent in the best way I'm able, in the best way I'm possible. And I would much rather think of life in those terms and have people think of me, again, by how I represent who I represent, as opposed to he represents X, Y, Z. And I think that that's a core value that you can take into anything that you do, no matter what.
Yeah.
No matter what profession or whatever your journey, wherever that takes you.
Yeah. Well said. Thank you. That's great. Okay. If any of you have questions, we welcome them. Anybody? Yes.
So for someone like me who didn't get into like seriously digging until this year, coming here to Loyola, how would you go about presenting yourself to someone who books gigs at like a small event such as the Willow?
I think tenacity is really important to have, but there's also a fine line, because I know how people are when they're approaching me for representation or they're approaching me to book one of my bands or whatever it may be. I think that there's just like a lot of nuances of life, there's an art to how you can do something, how you can be ambitious without being obnoxious. You can be tenacious without being obnoxious. You can be aggressive without being obnoxious. I think that if the goal is you're trying to get a gig or series of gigs on your own and you're representing yourself and you have all the tools in your toolbox that if you think back to even 10 years ago, let alone 20 years ago, that you have, which the ability just in the click of a button to give somebody a great representation of who you are, what your music's about, whatever the presentation is that you've chosen, whether it's clips, links, files, whatever, you know, with just a SoundCloud or a YouTube links.
And social proof, like numbers of streams and downloads, and you know, you can act, those things are public. When you see things on Spotify or on YouTube, the number of plays you get, people put it in perspective. They know, like, if you have 10,000 plays on a track and you're you in this little market, you're doing okay. So, you know, you have the opportunity to present a lot.
And if you're looking at an opportunity where you want to open for somebody at the Joy or at Tipitina's or at, you know, whatever it may be in town here or a House of Blues or something, and you're trying to get that gig and you're going after an artist that you believe you would complement the bill. And what we deal with on our side of it is a lot of times our bands may be taking their own support, carrying with their own opening acts on the tour. Sometimes first of threes are used or second of fours or first of fours, or there's plenty of times where somebody's doing something, it's local support. We're looking for a local idea. So we're going to rely on a promoter to tell us, you know, this band, they're starting to sell some tickets in town. They've got a good following. They've got X amount of likes and X amount of followers and whatnot. And that might be something that helps a band that might be coming to Tipitina's or the Joy that's worth 600 tickets, sell that extra 50 tickets or 100 tickets. Mm-hmm. Without representation, if you're a young artist and you're trying to do it on your own, or if you're a young manager representing a young group in town, it's definitely being tenacious and walking the line of trying to keep your presence up there without crossing the line.
First and foremost, you got to remember that you're a human dealing with other humans. You've got to speak in a real voice with real warmth, real character, real humanity, real humor, and not just endlessly hype, right? You can't just hype and hype and hype. You got to communicate. You have to build real connection between yourself and the other person on the end of that line. And that's what people react to. They react to your warmth, to your humanity. So, thanks for the question. Patrick.
Yes, sir. Might be a little bit inappropriate. My name's Patrick Bowden. I had spoke with you, been a couple years ago. I had a record that was being played in Birmingham on 95.7 Jams. And you had an artist, Jelly Roll, that was being booked down at Zydeco and with Lane.
About Jelly Roll?
Yes, sir. I actually called the receptionist and conned my way into speaking with you.
I'm not sure why we would speak about an artist that I don't represent, but go ahead.
Anyway, I spoke with Lane because I know Lane and also the promoter over at the Iron Horse.
Yeah.
And I was trying to open for those guys. Would have brought a big crowd in, I feel. But they said Paradigm was doing it, and then Paradigm said it was local. What would be the best way of going in there? I mean, if you've got something on the radio, you're drawing crowds places. I mean, what would be the best way to get in and open for those artists that are coming up like that?
It's a great question, and it's really an extension of the same answer. Mm-hmm. If Jelly Roll, there was a moment that our office booked him. Again, it wasn't me. I was never involved in it. But depending again on the tour and where they're playing, it's the same thing. They'll either be carrying support or using their own act that they choose, or there are the times where local support is needed. I mean, there's plenty of times where there's bands that I represent that I would love to get on tours for bands that I represent. Mm-hmm. That, you know, there's only so much you can do. At the end of the day, the person who's standing on the stage playing the show is going to be the one to ultimately weigh in, although many times, you know, a manager or an agent will have input. I'm not going to say that we don't, but ultimately, as I've found, again, because there's plenty of artists, like I said, that I represent that would like to play with other artists I represent that don't get that opportunity. Mm-hmm. It's going to come down to that artist or their manager or both making the final decision. But to the answer that we just gave and to what Billy just said, the best way to present yourself, I mean, you know, this is a business where you have one chance to make a first impression, just like in life. And so however that impression can be, we want to open up for Jelly Roll. And where was that gig at? The Lyric or Iron Horse?
It was at the Zydeco.
At the Zydeco? Okay.
I think he had Sonny Bama with him at the time. I mean,
okay.
My question was just merely because I paid to have, you know, friends open up for like Gucci and people like that, but there was no way that I could get in that venue, and that's the first time that's happened.
Yeah. And those are real frustrating. I mean, I hear it, man, and I'm with you on it. I mean, the only thing I could say again is that, and if that show didn't happen, you look at what happens in just Birmingham as an example, between Iron City, between the Work Play, between Zydeco, between the Lyric, which is now up and running. Those are great clubs and great little venues. So if you can find the promoters for those rooms and stay on their radar, maybe you don't get the Jelly Roll show, but maybe something else that's coming through town that is actually looking for local support is something that if your presentation is there and the right links and the right background info to back up that fact that we feel that we're worth 200 tickets because we played a gig at the Work Play, and this is how many tickets we sold, these are the records we've sold, we're getting airplay, we've had this amount of streams, we've geo-targeted what we've done in the market, and I can tell you, I mean, that data is useful to have. I mean, I'm sorry that that gig didn't work out for you. No, I am, because that's, you know, listen, I'm supposed to be calloused after 31 years. Yeah. I absolutely hate when I have to ever be a part of something that lets somebody down, including when somebody just knocks on the door and says, will you represent me? I mean, I feel that, who am I to say no? Who am I to say that your music isn't good? I would never say that to somebody. It's just my, whatever the circumstance or situation may be, but yeah.
It was the only situation I've never been able to buy my way into, to be honest with you.
Gotcha. Yeah. Got it. Thanks for the question.
So, I don't know how we're doing for time. What do we have? All right. Well, I'm sorry, but that's all the time we have. Thank you.